So, it came out of watching one or two very, very painful sorts of conference presentations. Those of you who have been to academic conferences will know of the example on the left-hand side, where people sort of get a bit glazed. I know there's a 3 o'clock or 2:30 to 3 o'clock in the afternoon when people do naturally kind of drift off. They've had a bit of lunch and then it's kind of got a bit late later on, and maybe they were up a bit too long for the night before. But we're trying to get away from that to that one, getting people engaged. Kind of relates a little bit as well to teaching students when we're doing that. But particularly in a place like this, the question is, why are we here? Suggestions. Why are we all here, folks? It is a multidisciplinary conference, so why are you actually here?
Knowledge sharing.
Knowledge sharing. Yeah. But why a multidisciplinary conference, not your domain conference?
To network.
Pardon?
To network with.
Networking.
Specialized.
Yeah. Because most. Yeah.
Maybe to get outside of the familiar box and to open to some new ideas from different disciplines, for example.
Yes, yeah. And that's really, really important, that those five or six different answers really make it rather clear about maybe the approach we take to a presentation here rather than necessarily in our discipline conferences. It may or may not, but I suspect actually it still has relevance to your discipline-based conference as well. Because we see far too many presentations there which are kind of standing reading. It's a first conference presentation, and they're very, very worried, and they've probably forgotten to number all the pages of this script. And so if they then trip over or they drop it, there's even more catastrophe, because the script isn't in the right sequence. So, a bit nervous, perhaps. But we are multidisciplinary, we're sharing knowledge. Look, there's lots of us here. I can sort of pick out perhaps some long in the tooth academics, professors, researchers, people who've only just started. Lots of different people here. And I try to find pictures of a reasonable range, knowing the sort of people who come to IJS regularly. So I've been here for, it's about sixth or seventh year, I'm not quite sure how many years I've been coming to Toronto's first, obviously, here. There's lots of different people, from very young to theoretically past retirement age. So that's at least this little span of 40, 45 years of age between the youngest and the oldest, probably. But you need to think, when you're giving a presentation, what does the audience want? More particularly, why on earth are you there over that side, compared with me here, why on earth are you bothering to listen to me? Kind of the same sort of answer, I guess. But you have to judge carefully what your audience wants. If it's in your discipline, and a typical IEEE, which is in my sort of area, you would have probably several, 1,000 or 2,000 people at the conference, and there may be six people actually sitting in the audience, because the rest of them are sitting outside in the sun, waiting. They're actually networking, I beg your pardon, out in the sun. But the people that you will actually talk to, those six people sitting over there, they're going to be pretty expert. They're going to know all the technical terms. They might well want all the numbers, the raw data, the statistics and processing, the algorithms. Because they are the expert, and they'll be able to give you a lot of feedback at that point. But come to a multidisciplinary conference, and that might be very, very different. We don't know your subject. You're going to tell us something interesting and fun and kind of far-reaching about it. So different audience will require a different approach. What we actually want when we're sitting that side is a story. Not a bare presentation of facts, but we want stories. Humans learn best from stories, from storytelling. That's why I brought that up in the keynote, because out there in business, when you are giving a business presentation to a group of managers or people above you or below you, we connect best with stories, analogies, and so on. And there's a little one on the right shows there. Storytelling is the way we connect the emotions with reason and meaning and the intellect. There are very few of us humans who are purely hard intellect. Most of us have emotion as well, and we use the two together. And so storytelling helps to get at the emotions and the memory and the connections. The other thing, another reason why we come here, as mentioned, we're inquisitive. We're coming here to this conference because we want to find out what's going on, all the interesting things. Sometimes we're trying to straighten out our tangled ideas. Well, we're just downright inquisitive, like the polar bear. Or the really great one, the children. Open to seeing what's out there, to hear about different things, about the constitution we just heard, or about the complexities and difficulties of understanding whether or not the tests about English language reading understanding are worth the paper they're written on, or are they just good enough. Sometimes we're looking for the one big idea that's going in a different direction. Most of us here are incredibly inquisitive compared to most people. I love this one. Now, Albert Einstein, the guy with special relativity and so on, declaimed, "I have no special talent, I'm only passionately curious." And that's what we, who come to this sort of conference, are typically about. About what's being presented, and about what's outside. Passionately curious about Montreal, maybe if you're going down to Toronto as well, seeing Toronto. Yeah, we're interested in lots and lots and lots of things. And that's kind of interesting what it says, what it has. Because we are trying to make connections. I remember talking to a colleague of mine in Derby, the university I come from. She was a Spanish language expert. And her particular area was South American poetry. And there was one particular poem that no one had been able to really understand how it worked or why it worked. And she made a staggering connection from literature, textual analysis, and all the usual tools, came up with something out of astrophysics, something called string theory. Don't ask me what it is, I don't understand it. But she discovered that there was something in the way it was described that connected with some of the stuff she was doing. And so she started applying an element of string theory to this particular difficult poem. Made that connection, and by golly, it actually helped her to explain, understand exactly how that poem worked. Now that's a really left field sort of connection. But the stuff we're doing here, I mean, just look at the list of papers being presented in here and in the other conference room. There's probably something fascinating in every single one of those presentations, which could trigger a new thought. If we go back to maybe something like that triggers a new thought. Or it helps us untangle the stuff. Hopefully, we don't stay in this incredibly tangled sort of web of ideas. You should be able to give me one idea from each of your presentations which will be of interest to me. It may today solve a problem for me, or it may be sitting in the background waiting for months or years. I don't mind which. I'll bet most of them come along and help solve something. So as you think about building your story, by the way, this is, I think, the only text slide here on this whole presentation. What's the big problem in your domain that you're addressing, and how does your smaller area fit in? Why is it interesting and important? And the subtitle for that one is, why should I spend my time as an audience listening? And you sometimes have to think about, as hard as that, turn the position around into the audience's way of looking at what's going on. We want to know, in essence, how you've approached the problem, what you've discovered, and what's the contribution to human knowledge. Those are the five of the critical questions. Now, one of the things here that we really do not want to see is that. It's not part of the story. It's just justifying to your examiners at the end of your PhD why the way that you've done the analysis of the data is actually fair and balanced and so on. I remember seeing at a conference a few years ago a chart about like that, which took up 10 minutes to 50 minutes discussing why it was, I don't know which bit it was, it wasn't that one, but it's another one. And you can see the eyes of all the audience glazing and lying down. It was rather sad actually, because the story that could have been told was really quite interesting if it hadn't got derailed on that one chart for 10 out of 15 minutes. Interestingly, this picture here is paired with that set of statistics. It's about accuracy of GPS as it happens, tracking, and it shows here how GPS trackers, monitors, are staggeringly inaccurate when they're switched on. But then they are not perfectly accurate all the time. Here, about half a minute later, there's another little blip. And then at the end, there's a huge blip as well, which are all infeasible motions of the car that was in it. And probably those ones are quite likely to be erroneous. But the statistics only caught those 5-6 points, and that's on the chart. And you can spend hours, I mean, if you would go back, you can spend a lot of time explaining that those top high values are somewhere in here, in these ones here. But it's so much quicker telling the story with that little wavy line. So, what I want to do now is, having provided some advice, give an example based on, kind of related to stuff I presented for some students of mine about 3 years ago. These are, remember, undergraduate students who are doing research for their final dissertation project, and three of them co-authored a paper for me. Now, the big context is this, that today we have staggering numbers of IoT, Internet of Things based sensors, smart devices all over the place, our smart fridges, our smart homes, our smart thermostats, Fitbits, location services on our phones and so on. And this is a big picture. This data is incredibly unreliable. So that's the big picture, the unreliability of our data. And as this guy, John Easton, pointed out, and this was back in 2012, he was saying, by 2015, well, we're now past that, 80% of all the data we have around us, all that big data that that first presentation talked about, the smart money, 80% is of uncertain veracity. We do not know whether it's right or wrong. We can't tell in isolation. If I take a photo with my phone, my smartphone, and it hasn't been used, I haven't used the camera for 10, 15 minutes, that photo will be randomly accurate. It will not focus, register here. Even if I'm standing outside in the middle of the road or on the balcony in my hotel just across the way, I don't. It will be somewhere, but it will be anything up to 200 yards in error. Just one snap, and that's all. Don't know. If I've got 50 photos taken over a period of 25 minutes in the same spot, maybe I can get within a few meters. And the same applies to all of these devices. So what the project then says, okay, here's lots of IoT devices doing all sorts of things, all sorts of inaccuracies. Let's focus on a single problem, which is easy to get hands around for students, location services and their inaccuracy. These just were the clues that triggered me to start concentrating in this area. Curiously, or intriguingly, a couple of years ago, in May I think it was, I was here in Montreal and went up to the top of Mont-Royal and took some photos right at the very top. Error, 5 kilometres. Shouldn't be. And then I just went up about 3 days later and took 50 photos. I took 52 photos right up the top by the base of the radio transmitter up the top there, every half minute. And two interesting pictures of the accuracy came out of that. This is the altitude calculation from a GPS location. And as you can see, it changes almost all the time. Intriguingly, even at the end of the 25 minutes, at that point, it is still something like 30 metres low for the point at the top of Mont-Royal. That's 231 metres, and that is 204 metres. So it's still massively under reading where it should be. And as you can see here, and the scale is, that's about 2 metres, and that's about 8 metres there, I think it is. You can see how, over time, the location is changing and moving. It's measuring, changing its GPS location all the time. Inaccuracy in these devices. It has, to put it into context, consequences, because a lot of companies are using that data from your smartphone through their own apps to identify where you are to send you a related advert for their products or something. You know, Starbucks will send you an advert saying you're just outside such and such a Starbucks, and yeah, that's okay, but as this background material shows, something like 35% of all location services-based adverts are out of place by considerable differences. And it's something like the dark blue one is 15% are more than 60 miles in error, 100 kilometres. And the consequence of this, you see, is that it is a vulnerability for their reputation. If I get an advert for something when I'm 60 miles from where they're telling me it's good, I'm going to start distrusting them. Hence the importance of this particular piece of research. So we've got the beginning, the big problem, data coming from these IoT devices, measuring, which aren't very accurate. We've got the location services as a more closely defined problem, using smartphones to, and then this is the consequence, which is why this is really, really important. Because it has real, business consequences. A couple of little extra ones. These are both GPS trackers that I've got for a camera. This is out in the garden, error, something like 3 meter error from where it's that centre there. Move it 10 feet across into the conservatory, which is plastic top, glass sides, and a brick at the back. Can't see as many satellites, much more error, 10 meters plus. And those from there, which is where it is, to about there, is kind of about 30 meters. So we're beginning to see you've only got to get out of the garden slightly into the house, and suddenly the accuracy is going downhill dramatically. Just two sets of data. I mean, there's a lot of points there that are collected at one second apart for a day or two. So I got the students 3 years ago or 4 years ago to collect at least 200 photos, the methodology. With a camera, at least 200 at known points using Google Earth, Google Maps to find the exact 6 or 8 digit latitude and longitude. Part of this was actually because I wanted them to collect more data than students usually do on student projects, where if we got them to do questionnaire, they will have, if we're lucky, 10 questions of rather indifferent quality, and they hope to get 150 in their methodology data. Going to try for 150 questionnaire responses, and towards the end they're getting a little bit touchy that they've only managed to find 5 people or 10 people to fill them in. We've been there, haven't we? And this was something that they could actually get a decent amount of data. Just go and take 20 photos here and 20 photos there, whatever, carefully annotated. So a minimum of 200 and more the better. And simply analyse the error. And these, I had 12 doing it, and these 7 students now are the ones who contributed data for the next little bit. So we've now got the methodology and why it's interesting, why it's valuable perhaps. Vishal Patel, he actually happened to have two cameras, didn't do too many photos, but it still shows very different ways of working. The iPhone has a long tail out to the 600 meter error. The Nexus phone, much, much more compressed, much less error. So the insight here is that different type makes of phone have different levels of accuracy. Dancora took in a whole lot of places across Derbyshire, and in one place, huge errors, 1,000 meter error. So what he then did was to look at what was causing that into Ambergate, and started looking at, okay, we'll separate it out into indoor and outdoor. Outdoor has up to about 50 meter errors, and the rest, kind of when you can look at it all overall, different types of buildings and so on, you got that type of error for his data. This was because they were Derbyshire stone, where the walls of the cottages are around about that big. Yeah. A bit difficult for the radio waves from the satellites to get in. You'll also notice, if you've taken any photos inside a conference facility like this, you'll discover, I mean, I got photos, about 8 photos from upstairs, 16th floor of the La Patron Hotel across the road. One or two on the balcony and one or two inside, but mostly on the balcony, and there's at least 2 of them which are over in the shop over there and over here. Now that's about 50-100 meter error, even on the balconies. So, and it's important in the over here in USA, Canada, because when you use your smartphone, your mobile phone, to call the emergency services, they just try to find out where you are. From your smartphone knowing where it is. Except, of course, it doesn't. And they don't know where they are vertically, so they can't tell whether you're first floor or tenth floor. And if you're inside, it's kind of unlikely it'll even be in the right block. So it has real significance, this particular research does, to characterize it. Viktor Hereshny, he discovered that chipsets are important, and the reason what he's done here, the HTC M8, with a modern chipset, was really quite a good level of accuracy, well, kind of reasonable, only 40 meters error, 50 meters, whereas the HTC Desire S, which is about 4 years older, I think it was, much, much less accurate. And these were all paired photos. So he would take a photo with the HTC M8 and the HTC Desire S at the same time, like that. Overall, across the 2300, 2400 photos that all the students took, 85% were within about 25 meters of where the phone actually physically was. The problem comes with the ones that aren't there. There were something like, well, a large proportion were within 500 meters. But there is still, what's that work out? About 60 photos which were worse than 500 meters error. And they are going to cause the businesses who rely on those readings significant problems. So that comes back again, summarizing the data and reinforcing the significance of why research has impact. Then looking forward, well, we bought a new little gadget, an Arduino, with a really quite good quality GPS tracker, which I didn't bring with me this time because having had the little hiccup or problems in London and in Manchester last week, we thought that it probably wasn't a wise idea to carry around bare electronics. Otherwise I'd take it to the top of Montreal with me. And I've also got a little Canon GPS tracker for my camera, which I did take up to the top yesterday, capturing 3,500 points per hour, 1 a second, for 3-4 hours. And what we're going to do is to collect a huge amount of data to start, and partly to compare devices, partly keeping at a known location to see whether that one at that size is more accurate than that one or vice versa, and also how they compare with these things which we are all using. Set of useful links for how to create, or thoughts about creating presentations, how to get your story created and presented. I say that the presentation, I'll get Joseph to circulate the links to the video and the presentation itself for you to use later on. Any questions, folks?